first conversations on race. And I learned that Debbie Irving, the author of that book, could have been writing about me. I grew up, I'm white. I grew up white. I grew up in Grand Rapids, Michigan. There were people of color in Grand Rapids, Michigan, but not where I live. There were people of color who went to high school in Grand Rapids, Michigan, but not the high school that I went to. There might have been four African Americans in my graduating class. I lived in a bubble. And then I went to Michigan State University, which is not known back in 1960, whatever, was not known for its racial inclusivity. And I lived in a world of stereotypes. The African American people that I saw walking around campus were Bubba Smith and the athletes. And the people who were in my math and chemistry and physics classes, those were white folk and maybe a couple of Asians, you know? I grew up white. And there wasn't much that pierced that unconsciousness. And yet it was a tumultuous time. You guys, 1963 was the March on Washington. 1965 was the year I graduated. You know, there was a lot of stuff going on in this country in those times, the Selma to Montgomery March. But I lived behind a veil. I just heard on NPR about W.E.B. Du Bois, who wrote about that veil. And I know you people of color know it from one side, but us people of white lived behind it and were kept from, many of us, from understanding or even knowing that there was a different world out there. I, in my pure northernness, could say it's all about those southern bigots. It's not me. It just so happens that I don't know any people of color. It just so happens that I am able to maneuver through the world comfortably and easily. Okay? Though I'm seeing some white nods. That veil continued well into adulthood. The year Martin Luther King was assassinated, I was having my first child in a strange town where I didn't know anybody. I cared about that. I didn't care about all the other important stuff that was going on. I'm sorry, but I didn't. I had my first brush with racial reality when my own children were growing up in Springfield, Illinois, which, you guys, is below the Mason-Dixon line. And in Springfield, Illinois, there was a white and colored beach. Now, not during the time that I lived there, but it existed in Springfield, Illinois. Anyway, during the time when my kids were in early elementary school, Springfield entered a desegregation consent decree. And the town was divided into quadrants and whatever. I had neighbors who took their children out of public school, so their children didn't either A, need to be bused across town where the black people lived, or B, remain in this school and have an onslaught of them come into the building. That was not my choice. I came to think less of my neighbors, but I also became aware of my own fear. What if they were right? This is my children. What if they were right? So a few little prickles of knowledge about the world that might not have been quite so white as I thought it was. I learned a lot when I came to Chicago during my second adolescence. This was when I was a single woman and my kids were in college, and I came and I lived in a coach house in Hyde Park. I took a handful of classes at CTS and at McCormick, and I developed an understanding, to some extent, about my own privilege. I learned, you know, in the sketchiest neighborhoods in Chicago, there are normal people. They are raising their children. They are working. They are having a life. What gives me the right to avoid being in those neighborhoods when there are so many other people who live there? Why is it that I don't shop there? What gives me the right to choose that? What gives me the right to allow my cab driver to take a different route from the airport to my house? So I developed some of that kind of understanding, but you know what? It wasn't until I fell in love with and married a sensitive and brilliant and gorgeous African American man.
For me, I can walk out.
and get lost again, or not lost, but fade into the white network that I was born into. I truly appreciate the conversations that we are having here about race, and I hope there are generational differences. I'm 71. I am hopeful that my 50-year-old son knows more than I did when I was 50. Certainly that he knows more than I did when I was 20. Same with my daughter. I hope there are generational differences. But I know that the time for conversation also needs to stop. Hey folks, we need to do something, you know? And I'm not sure of the venue for doing. Marching, sure, voting, sure, standing with, sure. But this has to stop. It just has to stop. We all need to work together to find some ways to deconstruct the systems and the structures and the institutions so that all of God's children are loved and recognized, not just those who happen to be born with white skin. Thank you.